Good morning. Good morning, St. James and family. It's good to see your lovely faces out there this morning. God is good, amen. Amen. For Psalms 100, 4 and 5 says, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. For the Lord is good. For the Lord is good. For the Lord is good. And his mercy endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. We ask that you help us enter in this service today. We want this to be corporate. We want y'all to engage with us. Amen.
To these gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with prayer. God is so good. How could you not just enter in and desire to commune with him and to sup with him and to have him sup with us? We want to welcome you this morning to St. James Missionary Baptist Church, where we fall under the leadership of our interim pastor, Reverend Sam Walton. We also acknowledge his beautiful wife, Rebecca Walton. Y'all give them a hand clap of praise, Lord, for this morning. We want to thank all of you who are viewing us, whether it be Facebook or whether it be YouTube. We want to invite you into your own private sanctuaries at home as you enter in worship experience with us here this morning at St. James. There's a couple of things that I want to mention before we get started this morning. We are so blessed and we are so favored, not only here at St. James, but all the churches within the city. But we do want to acknowledge a couple of our members who have done outstanding, wonderful, and tremendous things. And we want to speak on that this morning. One of the things is when school starts back, we have one of our very own who's coming back to be the vice principal at Kimmins Junior High in the person of Marion Kirsch. Also, we also want to acknowledge a young man who came up through the ranks of St. James. He was just multifaceted in many ministries here at St. James. He moved on to Tulsa, Oklahoma. But I want to announce today that he is an Emmy Award winner. That's in the person of Mr. Brian Smallwood. There are great things that we celebrate. Tremendous things that we celebrate here. Right now, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to yield to the deacon who is going to bring the scripture and the prayer. Amen.
Everybody say amen.
Amen.
And say amen again.
Amen.
Good morning. It is indeed a privilege and a pleasure to stand before you today and bring you the word. I assure you that God has a word for you today. Okay, a scripture today will be coming from Revelation 20. It's going to be coming from, actually, Revelation 21. Real brief, we're going to go down to 21 and 4. And it reads, "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain." Ah. "Neither shall there be any more pain." Any more pain. One more time. "Neither shall there be any more pain." Okay. "For the former things are passed away, and all things," "all things become new." May the Lord have a blessing to the readers and hearers and doers of this word, and may we be strengthened thereby. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you, Lord. Father God, I thank you. For your word tells me, Lord, that there will come a day when there will be no more pain, Lord. No more crying, no more tears, Lord. Just rejoicing in you and with you, Father. Father God, your word says you will never leave us or forsake us. And in that great day, Lord, we will dwell with you forever and always, Master. Father God, I ask, Lord, forgiveness, Lord, for all those under the sound of my voice. And I pray, Master, that we continue, Lord, to seek your face. Father God, I come thanking you, Lord, for another opportunity, another day, Father God, to have come to the throne of grace. Father God, I ask, Lord, that you prick our hearts, Lord, that you have not the things we say or do, Lord, hurt or offend anyone. Father God, let your light so shine through us, Lord, that we may love our brother as you commanded us to do, Father. Father God, we ask, Lord, that you touch our preached word today. Master, I'm lifting up to you, Lord, our first lady and our interim pastor, that you may continue to bless them, Lord, from the crowns of their head, Lord, to the soles of their feet. Father God, bless us today. Let us learn more about you, Father. Let us put you first, Lord, and us second. Father God, let us put you, Lord, in every step we take. Master, we ask all these things in your son's name. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And amen. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Deacon Van. And now we've come to a part where we all can participate. It's offering time. Amen. You know, we are so blessed that God is so gracious toward us that when we receive our paychecks or whatever stipend that we receive, God said, you keep the 90. I'm just asking for the 10.
All right.
So as we tithe knowing that we are doing what God desires for us to do, what is required for us to do. And in our giving, let's also not forget that we have a campaign that we are striving and we're going to push to get it out of the way, and that's the Burn the Mortgage campaign. Yeah. Doing an extraordinary job as far as chipping that thing away. It's kind of like eating an elephant. We have to take it one bite at a time. But I know with all of our help and with God's favor, we can get it done. So at this time, I ask if you would be so kind as to stand as we give our affirmation. Our affirmation of giving, if you'll recite with me. It says, the Lord loves a cheerful giver. Therefore, I give my tithes and offering joyfully and without hesitation. And so by faith, I declare that I am a lender and not a borrower. I am the head and not the tail. According to Micah 3:10, the floodgates of heaven are open and I'm living in the abundance of the overflow. Amen. Dear Lord, we thank you for this day, God. We thank you for another opportunity to give. But Lord, we give as you've graciously given us to us, God. So we ask right now that the offering that we take, that it be used to further kingdom building, oh God. Lord, we just thank you for another opportunity to be in your house and to be participating in this service on this day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and bless God. You're now in the hands of the ushers. Thank you. ain't tired yet. We are nowhere near tired yet. Again, I welcome you, all of you, through, whether you're viewing through social media, whether you're on YouTube or Facebook. We also want to acknowledge the ones who have come out to visit with us today. So if we have any first-time visitors or you're new in this area and you just so happen to drop in, I'm asking if you'd be so kind to stand at this time so we can acknowledge you. Amen. All right. So we're going to move forward. So the introduction of the speaker. We're going to go ahead and do the introduction of our speaker at this time. We have a gentleman who I've been knowing for quite a while, ever since he was a much younger man. But I've seen him grow up. As a matter of fact, it's something that he shares that I share with in my family, because his name is my grandson's name, and I didn't know it at the time when we first met. But he is man of God, right, trusting in God always. He currently serves as the chaplain for Rowell Parish Mortuary and Funeral Home Services. Very astute student. He studied daily, eats the word of God in order for him to know how to rightly divide the word of God. For some, I will introduce, and for others, I will present. And he'll be in the person, him and his lovely wife have decided to, she's here, thank God for her. Give her a hand clap of praise for being here. The next voice you'll hear from this pulpit after the choir sings is Reverend Xavier Lamar Griffin. Y'all extend your hand to him and say, Reverend Griffin, preach the word. Reverend Griffin, preach the word. Reverend Griffin, preach the word.
Can I add something? Y'all, Reverend Griffin, last weekend went to the Holy Convocation, and guess what happened? His name is Elder Griffin. All right. Better known, 29th Street, grew up right across the street. His real name is Mark.
Never will. I've been redeemed
redeeming blood. Yes, it is.
His blood still works.
Hallelujah. It's the cleansing blood. Yes, it is.
His blood still works.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's give him some praise. His blood still works. I believe it said his blood will never lose its power. Come on, somebody. Are there some witnesses in the house about the blood? My God, my God. Come on, somebody, let's give him praise. Come on, if you able to stand up on your feet. My God, my God. Can you stand up on your feet if you're able to stand on your feet for a man who hung up on a cross for over 9 hours? Come on, somebody. He's been good to you. He's been good to me because the blood, it still works. Somebody said that it reaches. Then somebody said it flows. And then somebody who witnessed said it would never lose. Glory, 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 hallelujah, glory, glory, hallelujah. Then somebody said that when they was taking communion, they said, I know it was the blood. Because one day when I was lost, he died upon the cross. Hallelujah. But in order for the blood to flow, what did they do? They pierced him. My God, my God. Come on, let's praise him. Hallelujah. We honor God today. Thank you, Jesus. Ain't nothing wrong with praising him. He said, let everything with breath praise ye the Lord. Don't be concerned about who's sitting next to you. Just because somebody in the building might know a little bit of dirt about you. I know a man who died for you. So give him glory. Give him praise. You might not get this opportunity again. So while I got breath in my body, I'm gonna give him the highest praise of hallelujah, which means all glory belongs. Hallelujah. We bless your name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I'm gonna give him praise now. Thank you, Jesus. I might not make it out the pulpit, so Lord, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I might not make it to work tomorrow, so Lord, thank you, Jesus. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. He's been good to us. Come on, look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I don't know about you, but he's been good to me. And the way I show how good he is when I lift up my hands, when I clap my hands. And then I just need about three crazy people just to... Oh, man, I see one. Oh, man, I see two. Oh, my God. Come on. I need some more crazy people that'll jump up and down. Hey, my God, my God. Hey, glory, hallelujah. I need some more crazy people, my God, to give him a crazy praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. I need some crazy people. Amen. Is there any crazy men up in the house? Amen. I see the crazy women. Amen. Is there any crazy men in the house that'll tell God how much you love him, how much you appreciate him? Is there any crazy men in the house? My God, my God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. For this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We bless your name. Thank you, Father. We ain't gonna move, amen. If you're not finished, we're not gonna move. Come on, if you still got praise, amen. Hey, man, we're not gonna move. I'm not in no hurry. He's been too good to me for me to be in a hurry. Let me tell you how patient he was. He waited some 20-something years for me to give my life to him. So if he can be that patient with me, I'm not in no hurry. I'm not in no hurry. There ain't nothing wait for me on the outside of this building that I can't give him praise and give him time. He woke me up this morning. My God, my God. Man, gave me the activities of my limbs. Gave me a right frame of mind. Come on, somebody. Amen. Amen. I'm just trying to see if the men gonna get crazy. Amen. I'm not stalling. I just believe I'm just waiting on the men to get crazy. Amen. I see the women. Amen. But I'm just waiting on my brothers. Amen. To get crazy. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. I seen somebody running around through the church because they love God that much that they said, God, these feet that you gave me, I ain't gonna let these stilettos and heels get in the way or these wedges. Hallelujah. We bless the name of the Lord. For God is good. And his mercy endure forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. That's it. Get your breakthrough. Come on. Somebody got a blessing on its way. My God, somebody got a blessing on its way. Somebody that's heard a song said, trouble in my way. I got to cry sometimes. I lay awake at night. But they said, but that's all right. Because what? Who gonna fix it? When? So before it happens, I'm going to step out in faith and give him praise for it now. But I know my breakthrough, it's on its way. So, Lord, hear my praise is. And God bless you. Amen. We thank God today. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. Come on, I can't move just yet. Glory, glory, glory. Amen. God said he won't share his glory with nobody. So look here, I don't want to get in the way of his praise. I don't want to get in the way of it. We owe it to him. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for blessing us. Hallelujah. We honor God today. We give him all the glory and all the praise. Father, we love you. We appreciate you. We thank you. Thank you for giving us access to you through your Son, Jesus Christ. And not only that, Father, thank you for the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. Ah, that is a comforter, a teacher. And we thank you today. And Father, I honor you right now. For who you are in all of our lives. And Lord, we say thank you again. Thank you again for putting breath in our body one more time. Thank you again, Father, for supplying and meet our every need. And Lord, we thank you. So, Father, as we prepare to move forward, we won't go without you. Like Moses said when he was in the mountain and he had to lead the children of Israel. Father, I'm not going unless your presence goes before me. So, Father, I won't move any further unless your presence goes before us. And Father, we honor you and we thank you. And the people of God said, amen. God bless you. If you're able to be seated, if you're able, I'm not telling you you have to, but if you're able, but if your tank is still on full, go ahead. I'm not telling you have to sit down, but if your tank is still on full, if you still got some praise left over from last week when you thought about what he done for you upon this week, if you still got some praise that maybe you didn't get, my God, that you didn't get out, and now it came back to your remembrance, I forgot to shout the victory for what he done upon this day and that day. So, Lord, you brought it back to my memory, so here comes my praise. Here comes that praise. I owe it to you. Praise the Lord. Amen. We honor God today. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. We give honor to Pastor Walton and his lovely wife. God bless you. And to all the ministering staff here at St. James, to all these amazing deacons. And to the body of St. James, God bless you. And to these musicians, come on, let's love on them. To the choir, amen. We bless the Lord, amen. I'm humbled today to stand before you upon this morning. As I come, amen, just bring greetings from Northside Church of God in Christ, where my pastor, Superintendent J.J. Watson, is the pastor. We bring greetings to you from Northside. Amen. So I promise I won't be before you long, because we're going to preach this together. Is that all right? One thing that I love about the gospel is we've all read it. We all know it. Amen. So the text we'll bring before you today out of Matthew chapter 14. I want to start at verse 27, if that be all right. Verse 27, if that'll be okay. Very familiar text. And it reads, "But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, Be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if thou be you, bid me to come unto thee on the water." All right. And he said one word. What did he say, church? All right, hold on to that. "And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. He began to sink. Then he cried, when a grown man cries, saying, Lord, save me. But look what the man done in the next verse. And immediately Jesus, what did he do? Oh, man, well, see, we preaching already. He stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him this powerful saying, O thou little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" Amen. So if you don't mind, for a topic today, we'd like to simply use developing a new attitude. If you don't mind, look at your neighbor and say, "Hey, neighbor, we are going to develop a new attitude." Huh? Is that all right? Now, oftentimes when we hear about something new, who in here doesn't like something new? I believe everybody in this room loves or likes something new. Oftentimes, it's something that we can purchase or even given to us. More than likely, it's something that we didn't have, but we want to have it. But how often do we simply say, "You know what? I want a new attitude. I want a new perspective and a new perception on how I look at the ways of this world and this life. I need a new attitude." Huh? And the only way this attitude can come is first that you have to acknowledge that the one that you have just ain't working anymore. Amen. So for a subtopic on the new attitude, because what kind of attitude are we talking about? It's a saying that we have always heard a number of times, but we don't hear it often. And I'm going to start it out, and I want you to finish it. Amen. Developing a new attitude called, "I got a feeling." Hold on, let me get on this side over here. I think, "I got a feeling. I got a feeling. I got a feeling. I got a feeling." A new attitude. A perception and perspective, which simply means my point of view of what is around me. It's my character and my personality towards the events either that I'm facing or that I have faced. But I want to focus on two words in the subtopic. The first one being feeling. We've all had them. We all have them. We're experiencing some of them now. It said it's an emotion state of reacting. It's a belief Some people even call it a notion, a hunch. You know how they say, I feel it in my gut. Huh? Then it also said it's considered to be the sixth sense of a person. Come on, we all had this feeling that if you're cooking something and you know how to cook it to my grill masters, amen, you can look at another man on the grill and you can look and say, that ain't gonna turn out right. Come on, somebody, can I get some help in here? Amen. Come on, where my domino players at? Amen. You can sit at the table against somebody who's talking all that good stuff, and when they play their first hand, you can lean back and say, man, they don't know how to play no bones. Come on, somebody. So that's that sixth sense that you believe. They don't know how to play, and they don't know how to cook. That's a feeling. But I want to talk to you about the feeling in the spirit realm. That feeling that I described in the spirit is called joy. Huh? That when I am experiencing some issues within my life or maybe in your life, some feeling called joy should come up in my life to where I simply say that even though this is happening, I still got a feeling that everything is going to be all right. But what is joy? It said joy is a feeling. It's good pleasure, happiness that is dependent on who Jesus is, rather than who we are or what is even happening around us. So now I'm going to get into somebody's business now. Are we going through anything right now? Are we experiencing anything right now? Or maybe you might know somebody that is going through something. So Nehemiah 8 and 10 says, for the joy of the Lord, it is our strength. Psalms 30 and 5 said, weeping may endure for what? But what comes when? In the morning. So hold on to that feeling, amen, of joy. Now there's another one. This also is one of the fruits of the Spirit called peace. So you can't experience peace until you got joy first. You can't have peace without joy. You got to have joy first, then comes peace. Peace is knowing that the Lord of the universe is by your side. Isn't that a great thing to know? He's right with you by your side. And you can rest in that, that no matter what life throws at you or me, because I get joy when I think about what he's done for me. And that, what, urges me into what? Peace. Then the next word I want to focus on out of the subtitle. All right. How often do we hear all right? Think about it. When you hear that word all right, sometimes it's comforting. The word all right is used to emphasize how certain one is about something. So if my feeling is a belief that I have, and now my all right is emphasizing on something that I believe is going to happen, so I just want you to look at your neighbor and say, hey, neighbor, whatever you're going through, it's going to be all right. Boy, I like that. She said, you got that right. Which brings us to our text. In the book of Matthew chapter 14, just want to build some more foundation here. Jesus just got bad news that John the Baptist had been beheaded. Jesus had got bad news that when they buried him, that his disciples, John the Baptist's disciples, had found Jesus and said, we got some news to tell you. Your cousin is dead. And the Bible said that a few moments later, Jesus wanted to be left alone. Come on, somebody. Ain't that what happens when we get some bad news or something bad happens to us? Sometimes we don't feel like talking. Sometimes we don't want to be bothered. Come on, somebody. Sometimes, hey, now the peace and the joy, I don't have it. But look at what Jesus done. The Bible said that he wanted to be alone, that he boarded up on a ship. And he cast away. And then the Bible said that the people heard where he was. That they walked on foot. Now I want you to imagine that course, later on in the scripture, it talked about how he fed 5,000. So can you imagine possibly over 5,000 people? All of them came together on one accord and said, we heard Jesus is over at St. James. So they didn't take a cab. They didn't have no cabs. But they walked on foot to get to Jesus. So in so many words that the Bible said that when Jesus saw them with their faith, he had compassion upon them. That he began to heal them of whatever disease or whatever issue that they had. Come on, somebody. All because what? They came looking for him. So in so many words, these people showed up because they had a spirit of expectation. So my question to all of us today is, do you have a spirit of expectation? Are you the one, like the song says, I'm looking for a miracle? Do you expect the impossible? Come on, somebody. Now I'm just building some foundation. Then the Bible went on to say that after he healed them, he said, man, they've been together for so long. He said, now I got to feed them. But if you always know that there's always somebody that's going to disagree with doing something good at times. His disciples said, hey, man, we ain't got enough to feed them. Send them home. Send them back home to where. And Jesus said, no. I just don't heal the body and the soul. I want to heal them physically as well. They need enough nourishment to make it back to tell somebody what I done for them. Not only did he heal my body, but he also fed me as well. Then the Bible said they began to do inventory. And when they did inventory, they only had 5 loaves and 2 fish. You know, and as I was studying up on this, I said, what kind of fish was it? I didn't hear nothing about no grill or no deep fryer. Come on, somebody. Because that's how we eat ours, amen, if it ain't fried, laid to the side, or with some hush puppies or something like that, or on the grill or smoke. I don't know what type of fish that they had. Maybe, I'm just assuming, please don't tell nobody I said this. Maybe when Jesus put his hands on it, maybe he cooked it too. I don't know. Because who in this room gonna eat some raw fish? So it couldn't have been raw. Who can take 5 loaves of bread and feed over 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread and... Jesus can. And Jesus did. So when I looked at, why did it mention 5 loaves and 2 fish? Why did it say 2 fish and 5 loaves? So I pondered on that for a little while, and I come up to the conclusion. How many weeks is in a year? So if there's 52 weeks in a year, that means God can supply your need. I'm gonna move on. So the Bible said that when they got through feeding everybody, that they took up the bushels. And it said there were how many baskets? 12. Now mind you that in this day and time, the men were only counted. 5,000 men. But according to studies, it said in this last verse, and said that they were eaten were about 5,000 beside the women and children. So in all actuality, he fed almost 15,000 people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. Amen. So if he can do that for them, what is he waiting to do? For you. I'm not talking about next week, but I'm talking about right now. Amen. There, I have seen in the auto market where they say, hey, on-the-spot financing. Amen. Jesus is saying, listen, I'm an on-time God. I can bless you right now. I don't have to wait to the end of Sunday. I don't have to wait to the beginning of next week. I just need you to have a feeling that you can simply say that, look, everything is going to be all right. So in so many words, Lord, here come my praise, even though it hadn't came yet, but here comes my praise. Because it said that when blessings what? I'm sorry. When praises go up. I'm just trying to make sure y'all was listening. building foundation. Now this is over. Jesus is sending a multitude away. So in so many words, he's dismissing the revival. He's sending them away healed, delivered. They didn't leave the same way that they came. How many people today, you might have came one way. But the question is, do you want to leave the same way? You might have showed up, pulled in a parking lot, upset and mad. But do you want to leave that way? Maybe something is not right within your home. But maybe you're the one that can change it, because he will change your perception and your attitude and how you're looking at what is going on in your home or on your life. So in so many words, Lord, give me a new attitude. Maybe not just, maybe on my job, or maybe amongst my family, or whatever it may be. Lord, give me a new attitude called, I got a feeling. Now we move forward and we find out that Jesus disperses the crowd, and then he tells his 12 disciples. I did say that, right? Don't take it back. He tells them, get on the ship. In so many words, I ain't forgot what y'all said earlier. Send these people home without feeding them. So y'all, get on the ship. That every time Jesus had virtue come up out of him, he took time to spend time, quality time, with his heavenly Father. So I need y'all to go ahead and get on the ship, and I'll hook up with you or meet you later on. Now, isn't it amazing that in the Bible, the disciples never did ask them, well, how are you going to get there? You normally travel with us. We normally use Peter's ship. Come on, somebody, just like we normally use somebody else's car. But how you going to get to where you're going? They just simply what? Got on in the ship. Then Jesus, the Bible said that Jesus went into a mountain apart to do what? To pray. And it said that when evening was come, he was there alone. No distractions. Just him and his Father. Now, keeping this in mind, now as he's praying in the evening, verse 24 said, but what, now the ship was in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. Now, in the evening time, in the Roman times, it said that evening time was between 6 and 9 p.m. Jesus is still praying. Now, all of a sudden, the Bible said that in the next verse, it said that in the fourth watch of the night, which is between 3 and 6 a.m., look how much time Jesus has spent with his Father, talking to him, receiving instructions, talking to him. Oftentimes, when we pray, we simply have a one-way prayer. We simply tell God about everything, but we never wait for God to tell us anything. So imagine what Jesus was talking to his Father about. Imagine him telling him John the Baptist had just been beheaded. So I know my time is drawing near. So I need seeing of the world. But I still have ministry to do. But look how alert Jesus is, that even while he's in the presence of his Father, he still notices those disciples are in trouble. The Bible went on to say that in the fourth watch between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. Now, it said that they are in the midst of the sea, which means the Sea of Galilee is 13 miles long. It's 685 square miles around. It's 141 feet deep. It's 699 feet below sea level. And how could a storm get that low? It said that the Sea of Galilee is the largest freshwater lake in Israel. And because it sits so low, cold air mixes with warm air and causes a storm. Just like right now, the sun is out. 2 minutes later, here comes a tempest and a storm. These disciples was not unfamiliar with this body of water, because they frequently
fish from out of it. But the Bible went on to say that in the fourth watch, Jesus loved them enough that even though they told him to send the people away, he left from out of the presence of God. And he did something that has never been done before. Now, if it's 13 miles long, what's half of 13 miles? 6.5. Jesus walked 6.5 miles. Come on now. Put that together. 6.5 miles. Just to get to his disciples. So if Jesus can walk, maybe he walked like that. However he walked, 3 o'clock in the morning, no light, because he was the light. Come on, somebody. He didn't need a light because he was the light, and he walked on water. In so many words, water had to behave. Jesus, that when Jesus stepped, it became solid. Come on, somebody. Look at the power of what Jesus had. That if Jesus can walk 6.5 miles to get to his disciples, what is he willing to do for you and for me? How difficult is your situation that you think is too far gone, or it's too far away, or it's been going on way too long? Jesus said, I can handle it. I just need you to develop a new attitude. Called, I got a feeling. The Bible said he's walking. Why wasn't he afraid when he walked and he was in the storm? The Bible said that the waves were crashing up on this ship. Here it was, this ship was 27 feet long, 7.5 feet wide, 4 feet 3 inches in width. But it said that the waves in that particular body of water would reach over 10 feet. So imagine 10-foot wave going over a 7.5-foot ship. It said that these men were scared. So can you imagine if I had 12 men to stand up right now? You don't have to. Can you imagine all the men, if there's 12 men in here, all of us, or in fear that we're gonna die? Can you imagine no hope on a ship? Can you imagine that even when they seen Jesus coming, you would have thought that they would have been relieved to know? But the Bible went on to say that when we are operating in fear, we lose our identity. We don't have any faith. We don't have any joy. We don't have any peace. Because what did Jesus say as soon as he seen them? He said, be of good cheer. I don't know about you, but how many storms have you been in and you barely can hear someone else speaking? So can you imagine? He didn't scream it. He didn't shout it. He just simply spoke to them in a nice tone voice. He didn't holler. He didn't scream. He just simply said, be of good cheer. So what is the Lord saying as you are going through your storm? He said, I'm speaking to you. Can you hear me now? He said, be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. Oftentimes when we are afraid, we are looking already for the end to happen. And even though it just started, we receive some type of bad news, we are expecting the worst to happen, even though it just started. We talked about in Sunday school about how Jesus is Alpha and Omega. That simply means he's the beginning and he's the end. And he said, also don't forget, I can move in between time. I can be at the end and go to the beginning. I can be at the beginning and work my way to the end. Then the Bible said, Peter said, Jesus, if that's you, Lord, anytime you see the word Lord, Jesus will always demonstrate how he is the Lord. The word Lord meaning ruler, master. He said, it bid me to come on the water. Verse 20, 29 said what? And he said to him, what? Oh, man, now we're going to have a spelling test. There's one word right there. I want you to see this. The word come. What's the first letter? With your eyes, spell it. Spell it. C. What was that? Say it together, boy. S-E-E. The next letter is O. Spell only. Now put the last two letters together. Me. Now put it all together. I'm not moving. I ain't gonna say another word. Jesus said, see only me. Huh? So whatever you going through, what did he say? He didn't say, see your neighbor, your cousin, your friend, your brother. He didn't say, see the church. He didn't say, see the deacon boy. He didn't say, see anything outside of him. If you are a born again believer, Jesus is looking forward to you coming to him, because I want you to see only me. Because as long as Peter had his eyes fastened on Jesus and he only seen him, he never would have sunk. And that might just be the reason why we are falling to the wayside. Oh, because I took my focus. I never had my focus on Jesus. I had it on everything else. I thought my blessing was going to come through me hitting a machine, doing it like this. I thought my blessing was going to come some other type of way other than through Jesus. He said, I'm a jealous God and don't have no other God. I'm just exercising before me. Bible said, when Peter was come down out of the ship, look what Peter did. When he had his eyes, when he seen only Jesus, I can see him coming down 4 feet. I think that's about 4 feet. I can see him coming down. I'm pretty sure the other 11 was like, Peter, what you doing? Can you imagine that first step? It's holding me up. Then he took, now look, he took that next step. I can see Peter's back straightening out, because now he's confident. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. So what am I saying? I hear the Lord saying, you need to put your feet down and then put the other one and then straighten up your back and be confident, because as long as you're looking at me, I have you walking upon some things you never thought you could walk upon. I have you walking upon some things. Peter walked on water, but he might want you to walk on something that you ain't never walked on before. Come on, somebody. Amen. All he needs you to do is keep your eyes on him. Bible said that Peter was walking. He was doing good. Come on, I'm almost finished. All of a sudden, the storm started getting the best of him. It said, and he saw the boisterous wind. Huh? And he became afraid. Let me tell you something about wind, W-I-N-D. The definition for the word wind is called intimidator. Think about it. When a natural storm happens, we see what the wind does. A tree as tall as this will begin to lean. Across the road, come on, somebody. The wind will begin to blow. And all of a sudden, the first thing we do is get what? We get afraid. Go to the bathroom. Come on, we remember the drill. Go to the bathroom. Everybody, get in the hallway. All of a sudden, then we hear the keynote speaker call them sirens go off. Now we really afraid. Then we turn the radio on. And now Channel 5 and the Doppler radar begin to tell us, it's close, get ready, it's close. So now we become even more fearful. So what is God simply saying? You got to be careful what you see and what you hear. Even though you may be facing something right now, you got to be careful what that situation is trying to tell you. And you need to tell that situation, I got a feeling everything is going to be all right. Then the Bible went on to say that here it was. He began to sink. He took his focus off of him. And then he said it again. He said, Lord. First he said, Lord, if that's you, bid me to come out this ship. Jesus said, come. Now he said, Lord, I'm starting to sink. And I want you to do what? Save me. What is God saying to us today? Come on, somebody. Some of the issues that we're facing, we are beginning to sink within them. But we need to simply say, precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, and let me stand. Come on, somebody. I need to get my focus back because I got a new attitude. Because I got a feeling that everything is going to be all right. And the Bible said immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand. And he caught him and said unto him, O thou a little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? Let that minister to us. Are you doubting right now? Have you been doubting? We pray that this stirs back up your faith to know all you need is some joy and some peace with a new attitude. All you need to start doing is looking at your situation and beginning to speak life and saying, I'm going to get through this. I'm going to make it because I got Jesus on my side. If Jesus can walk 6.5 miles, if Peter can walk however long he walked, whether he took one step or two steps, the point of it is Peter's testimony is, I walked on water and y'all didn't. Oh, ye a little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? Isaiah 40 and 31 says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall what? Walk. It's time for us to start walking. For we walk by faith and what? Not by sight. I'm coming to a close. Jesus had a new attitude. The Bible went on to say that as time went along, he was in the Garden of Gethsemane. And he asked his disciples, he said, cannot you pray with me for 1 hour? And the Bible said that they went to sleep. But the Bible said that Jesus went back to get some strength. That he went back and he prayed unto his heavenly Father. And he said, Father, I bid that you take this cup away from me. But after he prayed and prayed, he said, not my will. Let thy will be done. I'm coming to a close. Then the Bible went on to say that a feat that was getting ready to happen to Jesus was that now one of the 12 was preparing to betray him. My God. Came and kissed him. But see, Jesus had to have a new attitude. Jesus had to have a new attitude through prayer, and that's the only way you and I will ever be able to have a new attitude is that we have to pray to the Father and say, Lord, I need a new attitude, because Jesus did not want to take this cup. But once he received the strength that he needed, when the betrayer came, he said, do as you please. Imagine them taking him into custody. They made fun of him. Bible said that they stripped his clothes off, beat him with a cat of nine tails. Then they even beat him and mocked him, and then they said, prophesy who hit you. So we're talking about communion today. But what did Jesus do? The Bible said he never said a mumbling word because of his new attitude. The Bible went on to say that when they marched him from judgment hall to judgment hall, he never said a word. His attitude never changed. How many of us would be able to handle something close to that? But here it is, we have to give somebody a piece of our mind. And God is saying, I want to give you a new attitude. That when we get ready to take this communion, we should remember the sacrifice of the Father and the Son. If Jesus hadn't went to the cross, you and I would be doomed today. The Bible went on to say, amen, that now Jesus finds himself getting ready to go up on that old rugged cross. Now here it was, they done beat him and placed a crown of thorns upon his head. And now you're telling my Lord, my Savior, to carry this rugged cross to humiliate him. But he was willing. He was willing. One of the gospels said that there was a man that came out and carried it for him. But one thing we know, that Jesus was nailed to the cross. But that's not how the story ends. But in the ninth hour, the Bible said that he gave up the ghost. Come on, somebody. But then that's not how the story ends. That when he died and was placed in a borrowed tomb, that's not how the story ends. Come on, somebody. Amen. Then the Bible went on to say that Jesus went to hell. Amen. And when he went to hell, he went to set the captives free. Why did he do that? Because the saints of old kept saying, how long must we be in this holding place? So Jesus went to hell and he preached a revival to the saints to let them know that he was there. Come on, somebody. Then he didn't stop there, amen. Then he went to the devil, our adversary, and he stripped him of all his authority. Come on, somebody. Then he didn't stop there, amen. Then he preached again, and he let the devil know, I am the Word. I am the Son of God. I'm stripping you of all your authority. Then the Bible said, then he rose, and he was resurrected. But then before he left to ascend into heaven, he told his disciples, I'm not going to be able to be with you always, but I pray to the Father that he send you a comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, and he will be with you. Not only will he be with you, he will give you some power that you will become witnesses to the uttermost parts of the earth. How many witnesses are in the house today? Come on, how many witnesses in the house today? Come on, we're going to stand on our feet. I need a favor. I'm not a songbird. There's a song that said Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me. Can somebody bless us with that? Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch. Come on, all over the building. Come on, let's sing that. that's a sweet sound to heaven right there. Come on, let's sing that. My God, my God. There may be someone in the house today that you don't know him in the pardon of your sin. If that's you today that you want to experience that love that we were singing about, you don't have to leave this place the same way you came. That's one reason and one way never to leave a service like this. I can leave with other issues, but I should not leave this building if I don't know him in the pardon of my sin. So if there's someone in the house today that you want to accept him to be your Lord, when you accept him to be your Lord, you say, I'm giving you permission to take my life from this point. And then my Savior, I'm accepting you to be the Son of God, and I believe you to be, and I'm accepting you into my heart. So if that's you today, why don't you come? You don't have to be ashamed. The Bible said we all have sinned and fallen short. So if there's someone in the house today that you don't know him, why don't you come? This is the reason that we are here for communion. It said, this do in remembrance of me. That when we take the blood and we take the body, we're simply saying, Jesus, I'll never forget what you've done for me. Or maybe you might be standing in need of prayer. God bless you. Maybe you might have a special need. Maybe you might be the one that I need a new attitude. I need a new perception, a new perspective. I want to change the way I'm looking at life. I want to change the way how I see life. I want a new approach on life. If that's you, why don't you come? You don't have to be ashamed. We're family. You don't have to be embarrassed. We're family. If that's you today, why don't you come? You don't have to leave this place the same way you came. In Jesus' name. Bound, oppressed, sick, or lame, for the power of the Lord is still the same. You won't leave here like you came. In Jesus' name. Is there anyone else? Whatever it may be. Or maybe you want to stand in the gap for a loved one, family member, or friend. Whatever it may be. Might not have anything to do with you, but it's somebody you care for and you just want to see God move on their behalf. My God, my God. If that's you today, let him have his way. He loves you unconditionally. Jesus said, I come to give you life and that you may have it more abundantly. He said, you know why the devil is here. He's here to steal, to kill, and to destroy. He said, I come that you may have life and you may have it more abundantly. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. Glory. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Have thine way. Have your way. God bless you. God bless you. bless you. Top of his head to the soles of his feet. We bless your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you.
Please remember that we are still in the attitude of worship as we come to this part in our service. For I have received the Lord, which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after the same manner, he also took the cup when he had supped, saying that this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do, yes, as often as you drink it in remembrance for me. As often as we eat this bread and drink of this cup, we do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whomsoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For we have eaten and drinking unworthily, eateth and drinking damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause, there are many who are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, and that we should not be condemned with this world.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we pray that you would bless this bread that represents the body of Jesus Christ and the fruit of the vine which represents his shed blood. Lord God, as we take this, Lord God, his blood and his body, Lord God, we do it because you told us to do it in remembrance of that sacrifice of Jesus Christ for the remission of our sins. So Lord God, we thank you and we bless you for this opportunity to honor this holy sacrifice. In Jesus' name, amen. If you would all stand and come to receive the bread and the wine.